Hey, that was Democracy Now!, and this is WFMU East Orange, WXHD Mount Hope Worldwide on the World Wide Web at WFMU.org. My name is Tom Scharpling. I'm going to be your host for the next 180 minutes here on WFMU with the best show on WFMU. So please stay tuned for something from the Velvet Underground.
Yeah. Saturday's good. Say no to Saturday. Saturday's good. Say no to Saturday's good. Well, you're looking real sharp again. And if I'd only close my to go, but I'm keeping my eyes open.
between the bodies I've created and a life and death I destroy myself. I rise from death, I kill death, and death kills me. I resist between the bodies I've created and a life and death I destroy myself. I rise from death, I kill death, and death kills me. I resuscitate the bodies I have created, and alive or death, I destroy myself.
Good evening, fair partygoers. Welcome to the best show on WFMU. My name is Tom Scharpling. I am your host for the evening. Perhaps one might say I am your host for the evening. Or if you were a little more daring, you might consider me your host for the evening. We are here until 11 p.m. 180 minutes of mirth, music, and mayhem. And on the other side of the glass, we've got Dave, the show's associate producer, running things. Dave informs me that the show, while it is billed as 180 minutes of mirth, music, and mayhem, perhaps it should be thought of as 60 minutes of mirth, 60 minutes of music, and 60 minutes of mayhem, not in any sort of consecutive order or checklist order. You're going to get 60 minutes of music, you're going to get 60 minutes of mayhem, and 60 minutes of mirth at various points throughout the evening. The phone number, 201-200-9368. And as you know, tonight is Tuesday night, and that means it's what? That's right, Open Phone Tuesday. And what does that mean for you, the listener? Why, it means you call 201-200-9368. That's 201-200-WFMU. And you will get through. The email address, for those of you who have email access but no telephone in your house, your best bet is to email thomas@wfmu.org. That's also good for my friends who listen on the computers. thomas@wfmu.org. You write it, I read it. It's instantaneous. Oh, it's like lightning. Hey, what music did we just hear? Well, I'd be happy to tell you. Hypno Love Wheel from their debut album, Turn, Turn, Burn. And has there been a greater debut in the last 20 years? The Days of Wine and Roses. No! Is this it? No! Turn, Turn, Burn. Come on, everybody. It's got cows on it. That's what we just heard, cows. It's got Living on the Moon, Louis Armstrong, Hangman's Picnic, My Third Eye. Right now, you can't argue with this record. And we heard cows from Hypno Love Wheel starting us off. Ah, before that, from Uncle Wiggily out in this area, New York, New York, featuring WFMU's own William Berger. We heard the Antichrist Fan Club, taken from their album, which I believe was self-titled, on the Nur Shk record label. Oh no, the album's called He Went There, So Why Don't We Go? Antichrist Fan Club. Ah, the Human Switchboard before that, giving us Say No to Saturday's Girl from their great album, Who's Landing in My Hangar? Another great debut album. And starting us off from the Velvet Underground bootleg series, Volume 1, the Robert Quine tapes, we heard What Goes On, which was performed way back in November 8th, 1969, so it was almost
32 years and a day away.
Well, how about that? 32 years and a day away. That was recorded. WFMU, you're on the air.
Hello?
Hello?
Hi.
Hi.
Did you ever get to check out Jim Pepper and Richie Taito?
No, I didn't. I looked. Actually, I think I did look for it. I couldn't find anything.
Oh.
Sorry.
Well, there's an 8-minute version that you're going to love.
Okay. If I ever come.
Search on the net, you'll find it.
Jim Pepper and Richie Taito.
Yep.
I had it written down from that. You called when we were discussing Frank Zappa, right?
Yeah.
Hey, did you go to the WFMU record fair?
Excuse me?
Did you go to WFMU's record fair?
No, why?
I'm just asking.
Oh, I thought maybe there was something about Jim Pepper there.
No, I don't remember any news on Jim Pepper at the record fair. But I do remember hearing a couple people mumbling something about Richie Taito.
You do?
Yes.
Oh, man.
And you know what they said?
You can't get the album. I mean, you can get a used copy, but it's not...
How much money do you have in the bank?
Oh.
Approximately.
I don't like to say...
Well, just what, are you 5 figures, 6 figures?
Enough to buy a used record, if that's what you're getting at.
No, that's not what I'm getting at. Do you have $30,000 in the bank of disposable income that you could lose tomorrow and you wouldn't feel it?
No.
No. Do you have $30,000 in the bank, period?
Yes,
you do. It sounds like you do.
Not in the bank.
Here's what you do, though.
Spread around, you know.
Okay, you got it spread around. Here's what you do. You ready?
Yeah.
Here's what you do. You get your money together, right?
Yeah.
As much as you can get. You reissue the Jim Pepper and Richie Taito record if you feel so strongly about it. Put your money where your mouth is, my friend.
Oh, man. No, but, you know.
You should do
I'm
it.
I'm only saying this because I think.
It could be your calling.
I think you'd like it.
I'm sure I would, and I'll like the free copy you send me after you reissue it. I think you should do it.
You're a radio and a music guy. I figured you'd have a better shot at getting your hands on that.
But you want to know what it is a lot of times? People in life get one shot, right? One chance to grab that brass ring. $1 million idea in their whole lifetime.
Well, this is
this could be yours. This could be yours.
Yeah.
It could lead
to
other.
It would be a nice thing to do, but I don't think I'd make $1 million.
It could lead to other things, though. Because this is how it could play out.
That's nice.
What's your name?
Owen.
Owen. Oh, okay. How's this sound? Step one. Owen gets enough money together. Owen cashes out some of those mutual funds and stock options. Step two. Owen takes that money, puts it in a bank account, in a checking account. Step three. Owen finds out who owns the rights to the Jim Pepper and Richie Taito album. Step four, Owen takes some of that money, licenses the Jim Pepper and Richie Taito record, puts it out, reissues it, featuring bonus tracks and alternate takes, maybe even a demo, with exclusive liner notes written by who? David Frick. That's right. You got David Frick to write the liner notes. Step four now? Step four, the record sells moderately well. Makes a little bit of money, but it looks like Owen has a record label. Step five, Owen takes the money from the Richie Taito album, and what's he do? He puts out another record for, you know, with that money. Step six, that record goes on to enter the Billboard charts at number 8.
Yeah, I think that would be the Columbia Princeton electronic music album.
Step 8.
From 1960.
Owen is richer than he ever dreamed. Step 9. Owen sells this new record label.
To Amit Ertegun. David Geffen.
You sell it to Amit Ertegun and the Atlantic family for $15.5 million. Step 10.
And then I give that to FMU.
Owen donates
during their drive.
Owen donates $1.5 million in a good faith gesture to WFMU because this is where his dream came true.
And I make that pledge on the doing the best show on FMU's Hour of Fledging Time.
I'd hope so.
Sure.
Where else would you? Oh, it's like, oh, yeah, my dreams came true thanks to Tom mapping that thing out. I think I'll call my pledge in during Greasy Kid stuff. Now you're getting me mad, Owen.
Oh, no, but I...
Get off my phone. I shouldn't have hung up. Okay, I jumped the gun on that one. I shouldn't have hung up on you like that, Owen. I apologize, Owen, for hanging up on you. Got an itchy trigger finger tonight. Anyway, the phone number, 201-200-9368. The email address, thomas@wfmu.org. We are here to entertain you. Now, what's going on? Oh, you know what? It seems like with this show on Tuesday nights, when this show started, a big part of the program was me trying to get some listeners for the show, right? So the show started last October. We were actually into the past the 1 year mark of the best show on WFMU as of a few weeks ago. But when the show started in October, this is how October played out. We had the World Series. Then we had on a Tuesday. Then we had Halloween. Then we had the closest presidential election in the history of mankind, all on Tuesday nights. So I took a hit in terms of building an audience early on. Thankfully, with some successful data marketing and general polling and bulk emailing and pop-up ads, I was able to spread the word about the show. I'm considering doing these pop under ads. But that's not what I'm talking about now. So anyway, the show we did our show last year up against the election of 2000. And now we find ourselves in the year 2001. And we are up against the 2001 election, which is not as monumental as last year's election, but we've got the governor of New Jersey that is up for re-election. Actually, neither governor is up for re-election now because Christy Whitman went into the Bush administration and left behind I think his name was the person she appointed to become the temporary governor of New Jersey. I think his name was it something like Boffo the Clown or something like that? He was just literally like the most pathetic example of a politician imaginable. A guy handed the keys. He couldn't get away from all that illicit construction, though. So now we've got Schindler against McGreevy. I wonder who people voted for out there. You can call up and talk about the voting that you did today. Or in New York, the mayoral election with Bloomberg against Green, which was a little more heated than the... the gubernatorial election in New Jersey. So if you want to talk about who you voted for and why, we can talk about that. Or, you know what, I also the record fair. There's like the record fair just happened. I mentioned it to Owen, who just called. This past weekend, it was an exciting record fair. I was there for the whole thing. I want to thank everybody who came out to the record fair and who spent their money entering the building and buying records there. I want to thank those people for coming down and making it a successful record fair. What kind of stuff did you find at the record fair? Did you find anything exciting? Any action? Any record you were looking for 10 years that finally came into your life? If you had anything happen to you at the record fair that is of interest, give me a call and let me know how you made out at it. Oh, another interesting... You know what I found at the record fair, which was interesting, was there was this one fellow selling grab bags. I think he called them fun bags, actually, to be more specific. And these bags were only a mere $2. Oh, and boy, were they fantastic. I bought one, I opened it up, I said, now, for $2, I can't expect anything exciting in here. And the gent told me, no. Get ready to be surprised. So I opened the grab bag and I said, you know what? You're absolutely right. This is fantastic. The stuff in here is so great. Thank you, sir, for letting me buy it with $2. I appreciate you taking my $2 and allowing me to buy one of these fantastic grab bags. And he said, you know, the smile on your face, my friend, is worth every cent of these $2. And he proceeded to take the $2 and set it on fire right in front of my eyes. And I said, wait, why are you burning my $2? He said, because it's meaningless. What is money after all but a tool of oppression? And I said, well, you could have given me the $2 back if you were just going to burn it. And then he said, you need to be freed from your oppressors, my friend. And I said, wait, what are you talking about? And it went on for about 15 minutes after that. Hey, WFMU, you're on the air.
Hi, Tom.
Hi.
This is Kate 2.
Hey, how are you, Kate 2?
Now.
What's that?
Just Kate now.
You're just Kate because Kate 1 has reverted to her given name.
Her real name, yeah.
Natalie. Mm-hmm. So you were at the record fair, Kate 2, or Kate.
I was.
And did you have fun?
I did, but I kind of had a disappointment.
What?
I couldn't find any Noise Toys records.
You couldn't find any Noise Toys records?
No. That's one of the reasons I went there.
Did you look at every single table?
That would have taken me like 3 days.
Well, that's well, you know how long the record fair was?
What a
3 days.
Yeah, but still, that would have been tough.
It would have been tough for you to do that.
It would have.
Well, you know, there's... I can only say better luck next time. Did you find anything you were interested in?
Yes.
What did you find?
A WFMU t-shirt.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's nice.
I was too lazy to look through all the record bins.
Yes. Well, did you enjoy yourself, though, ultimately?
Yes. Yeah, I did.
Did you have fun?
Mm-hmm.
Did you meet any WFMU DJs?
No, except you. But I already know you.
Yeah. You didn't meet, let's say, the Cosmic Cowboy?
Was he the guy in that funny suit?
No.
No. The cowboy was there?
The Cosmic Cowboy was there, yes.
What did he look like?
He looks like he's very handsome. He looks kind of like Kevin Spacey in the movie K-Pax.
Mm-hmm.
Are you familiar with the movie K-Pax?
I've heard of it.
He looks like Kevin Spacey in K-Pax. His nickname at the station is K-Pax, actually.
Really?
No, actually, that's not true. I just made that up. But were there any surprises at the record fair?
No.
No?
No.
How long were you there for?
Probably like 4 hours.
Wow.
Yeah. Had a good time.
Good. Oh, I'm glad you had fun.
Yay.
So, you didn't buy any records, though?
No, I left my money at home.
Okay.
forgot to bring it with me.
Nobody would spot you the money?
No.
What? Come on. Your parents wouldn't spot you the money?
My dad was with me. And,
uh-huh.
You know, it's his money.
It's his money?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. How do you get money?
It just appears in my pocket.
Uh-huh. But do you do chores?
Do you
babysit?
I work for my mom sometimes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Doing what? Running errands? Sweeping up?
I don't know.
Well, you must know because you do it. What do you do?
I mow the lawn.
Okay, well, I guess you're going to be out of business for about 5 months now.
No, I mow it when the snow is there, too, actually.
Okay, so you just are a very stubborn person. You mow it regardless of the month.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, you know, you've got to stick to your guns, mm-hmm. No matter how scary they are.
Scary guns, that's right.
Yes. So, well, Kate, I appreciate you calling.
Sure.
And you you have a good night. It was nice seeing you at the record fair.
You too.
Did you see, your fellow teen friend, Nadia?
Mm-hmm.
And did you guys hang out and have a soda?
No, we had pretzels.
You had pretzels together?
No, we didn't.
You didn't?
No.
All right. Well, thanks for calling, Kate.
Okay.
All right, you have a good night.
Bye.
All right, bye. In our newsroom, we just received a news flash. Coming in, with 2% of the precincts reporting, I am ready to declare, through no actual... Actually, no, I can't say that. Maybe I'll get, like, sued or something. But, apparently, CBS... says they are predicting that Jim McGreevy has won as the governor of New Jersey. How about that? Let's see if I can find it on the old computer here to confirm it. So anybody, I want to hear anybody's record fair adventures. Anything exciting that happened, anything weird that happened, anything, just anything. What were your impressions? Did you enjoy yourself, everybody? And the other thing we can talk about? That's right. The New York Yankees go in the tank. I say they should be called the Tankies now because they tanked hard. Nice job, Mariano Rivera. Yeah, that was nice flop job there. Now my relationship with the Yankees is strange because I grew up rooting for them. But then at some point I stopped liking them. I think when they became successful, I think I stopped liking them. I don't know what that's all about. I guess I always have to root for the underdog, but I ended up rooting against them at a point. But then when I see them play, I can't hate them the way a lot of people hate them. Like, I talk to a lot of Met fans who just hate the Yankees and were just glad to see them lose. And I can't say that I was as glad to just see them lose. Like, I wasn't like, oh, they got what they had coming, finally. But I know there's probably a lot of disappointed people out there listening, and I'd be willing to talk to you about your disappointment. WFMU, you're on the air.
Hi. I have some record fair stuff that happened.
Okay. What's your name?
Linda.
Linda? Your name's not Linda. You know how I can tell?
How?
Because you stammered for a second like people don't remember their name.
Well, I don't want to use my real name.
It's like this. What's your name?
I'm not going to tell you.
Linda. It's like, oh, that's right. My name's Linda. Your name's not Linda. What would you give me if I guessed your name?
I don't know. I might not be able to tell you what happened at the record fair if you guess my real name.
Okay, I won't do that now.
Okay.
Okay, so what happened at the record fair?
Well,
Linda.
I saw three guys I had failed romances with and successfully avoided each one.
Now, where were you at that point?
I was around. I was just sort of around.
And did you managed to avoid them. They did not see you?
They did not see me.
So what, did you duck?
I did actually hide on two occasions.
Like, openly, were they nearby and you just, like, hid? Like,
yeah,
like behind
I just, like, hid behind another person, and then I walked around to another part of the record fair, mm-hmm. and just, like, you know, like, looked through some records and tried to sort of hide my face and stuff, and, yeah.
Now, three failed romances.
Yeah, it's pretty sad.
Who was the one responsible for breaking up in these relationships? Who pulled the plug? You did. That's why you were avoiding them.
No, in one instance I did.
Mm-hmm.
In another instance, the guy pulled the plug.
Now, how about in the third one?
In the third one, it just didn't gel. Like, so I went out on a date with this person, and it was just really bad. Like,
so it just fizzled out. It was understood between both parties. So
yeah.
What was the longest amount of time that you were going out with any one of those, I guess the two people, because the third one, it didn't go beyond a first date?
Yeah.
How long were you going out with both of those people?
Maybe like a couple of weeks.
So you were going out with them a couple weeks each?
Yeah.
Okay. And so you dumped... Why did you dump the one person?
Well, he didn't have a sense of humor.
Okay. And what's his name?
I'm not going to say.
Okay. Now what...
I shouldn't say.
Okay. But you will. So
no,
what's his name?
No, I'm not going to.
What's his name?
I'm not going to give you his name.
Tell me his name.
Andy.
That's a lie. I can tell that's a complete lie. But that's just a lie to placate me. Like, what do you think? I'm just going to go, duh, okay, Andy. So you're going out with Andy, Linda. Oh, I know your name.
No, dude, don't say it.
I'm going to say one thing, though.
What?
I'm not going to say your name.
Okay.
Is there I'm going to give a letter. You tell me if that letter is in your name.
Okay.
It won't be the first letter of your name. Okay?
Okay.
You ready?
Yeah.
You know, what letter do you want it to be in your name?
I don't know. I'm not going to tell you what the letter is.
I mean, no, you don't tell me what the letter is, but what number letter? Do you want it to be the fourth letter in your name?
I don't care, really.
Well, just so you know, I know who you are.
I don't know. You pick a letter.
I will say the fourth letter in your name is a vowel.
Okay.
Am I correct?
Yes.
Do you want me to say that letter?
Well, you could.
That letter is I.
Oh, you're right. And I think if you guess any more, I better just sort of hang up.
Sort of hang up?
Yeah.
There's no middle ground with hanging up.
Well, maybe I should hang up now because it's kind of like...
Hey, guess what? We have somebody on line 8. Checking in. He says he has a good sense of humor and could last a week with you. Do you want to talk to this person?
We'll see. Oh, yeah, okay.
Let's see. Let me see if I can make this happen. Let's see. Let me try. Nope. Nope. Hello? No. WFMU? Can you hear me, caller?
I'm still here.
I can hear. Okay, you're still there. But this guy, Chris, I cannot get him on the air at the same time with you. Do you want to just listen to him?
Yeah, okay.
I'm going to talk to him now, then.
Okay.
All right, well, thanks for calling, Linda.
Should I hang up?
Yes.
Okay, bye.
Okay, bye. WFMU, you're on the air.
How could this be the best show if you didn't pick up at the right time? You didn't punch the right button?
That's technical stuff, my friend. It's a complicated phone system here. How dare you put me on the spot like that?
I know, I help pay for it. That's all right.
So what's your deal? You say you can last a week with Linda. Do you know Linda?
No.
You don't know who that is?
That's not a real name, and that's okay by me.
Okay, but you're just saying, are you a single guy?
Yeah.
And you're saying that you could last a week with Linda?
Yeah.
Are you saying you want to ask her on a date?
Well, sure. We could go on one date, and then we'd, like, make plans for, like, the next date.
Okay.
And then she would cancel it, and that'd be like going out for a whole week, right?
Mm-hmm. But you would be willing to go on a date with Linda?
I'd pay. She wouldn't have to pay.
Okay.
She wouldn't have to pay.
So there's an offer. So what do you look like, Chris, if you could describe yourself?
Well, let's see. Probably a little, okay, 6 foot.
Okay.
Relatively athletic.
Okay.
Not bad looking, I guess.
All right. Who do you look like? Anybody famous?
Well, not Danny DeVito.
Okay.
I'm taller than him. I have more hair than him. Different color hair.
Wow, you're really selling yourself here. So wait, you mean you're actually taller than Danny DeVito and you have more hair than him? Wow, I think I might go out with you.
But I've never driven a taxi. So.
Well, neither did he. He ran a taxi company. Although at one point, I'm sure if there was a taxi prequel, mm-hmm. we would have seen a young Louis De Palma scraping together money, driving cabs to open up his own cab company. But, you know, they never filmed that.
You know, the interesting thing about Linda is if all three individuals were in the room at the same time, how did she hide from all three of them at the same time?
Well, it might have been over the course of the weekend.
I understand that, but it would have been quite a traffic pattern going on there.
Yes. Now, I would be interested if Linda wants to call. You know what I'm going to do, Chris? I have to clear the line.
I understand.
So that I can make this phone system happen.
The best show.
No. Just so I can make the phone the phone system happen to get the two of you on the air at once. I want you to talk to each other tonight. I want to make a love connection for Chris and Linda. So I'm going to hang up on you.
Okay.
But I want Linda to call back.
Okay.
And as soon as she calls back, I'd like you to call back.
I'll try that.
Okay?
And
thanks,
we'll
Chris.
We'll see if Danny DeVito beats me to it then.
Well, no, just let's finish describing yourself,
okay.
though. So do you look like, let me name a celebrity, you tell me if you look like them. And we'll do warmer or colder.
Okay.
We will do, let's see, do you look like Lou Reed? Do you look like Bill Gates? Are we getting warmer?
A little warmer.
A little warmer. Do you look like a young Larry King?
Probably warmer, yeah.
Okay.
But younger. Like before, like six or seven of his wives or something.
Okay. Do you look like one of the Smothers brothers. Which Smothers brother do you look more like? Tom or Dick Smothers?
Probably Tommy. I'm a little smarter, I think. Tommy.
Now, which one is he? That's the second question.
The blonde one.
Okay, so you're the spitting image of Tommy Smothers.
Not the spitting image.
I would
He's
not.
He's got rounder ears and rounder head.
Okay, so you.
But is Linda old enough to even know who the Smother Brothers are?
Okay.
What if she doesn't get Nickelodeon?
Well, that's what you guys are going to have to talk about on your first date. And I want you to have that date. You know when I want you to have that date? On my show.
Ooh, that'd be interesting.
For 3 hours, I want to have a date here. Maybe I'll have food
that
for
long?
You. A three-hour date, yes. And I'll even have a little...
Would she have to bring, like, trunks of clothes, like Tina Louise or something?
No, it's not a 3 hour. You're not going on a cruise.
Oh, I see.
But I want to also have a little area for the two of you to get more, you know. You know, when that starts going down. You know, the...
Do you think she has the stamina for a 3 hour date?
Well, it's not 3 hours of that.
Oh, I see.
It's just a 3 hour date. I don't know if I want you going out with Linda on this
exactly.
date. But you know what? I'm going to, and you know what? Chris, I'm going to hang up on you. And the second, but I'm telling you I'm hanging up on you. The second you hear Linda call in, you call right back. Okay?
Okay.
Promise me.
All right, I promise.
Say, I promise.
I promise.
That I will.
The best show, that I will call back.
The second,
I
hear Linda's voice.
All right.
Say all of that together.
I promise I call back when I hear Iris's voice or whatever her name is. Linda's voice.
I'll accept that. Okay.
Okay.
I'm hanging up on you now.
Thank you.
Bye. All right, Linda, it's time for you to call back. 201-200-9368. And, by the way, you're listening to WFMU East Orange, WXHD Mount Hope, worldwide on the World Wide Web at WFMU.org. The email address, thomas@WFMU.org. The place to get in touch with me. Are we good there?
We're good.
Let's see. How does we do this? No. It's a learning experience. Hang on, people. No. No. Rich doesn't know nothing about nothing. WFMU, you're on the air. WFMU. Phooey on you. Don't tell me this phone system is not going to work for me to put these two potential lovebirds on the air at the same time. Linda?
Hi, it's Linda.
How are you?
I'm doing okay.
I'm sorry to tell you, I don't know if I can put your potential love connection on the air with you.
Oh, really?
I'm going to have to sort these technical problems out. I'd love to. Oh, if this is him, I can do it.
Okay.
Is that him?
That's him.
I think I can do this. He hung up.
Aw.
No, he's still on hold. Hold on.
Okay.
WFMU, you're on the air.
Hi, I'm still here.
I know you're still there. WFMU, you're on the air.
Hello, is this Tom?
Yes, it is.
You have a second to chat?
What's that?
You have a second to chat?
Sure, this is not Chris, is it?
No.
Okay.
I've called before, though. I didn't say my name because I was afraid of physical harm.
Oh, I know we've talked to you. This is not the guy from the that office.
Yeah.
How are you doing?
Well, I don't know. I'll briefly recap. My plan tonight was to I guess my plan was to maybe call in and present my situation and then listen. You know, to maybe some other callers will call in with some advice or something.
Okay.
So, just to briefly recap,
We got a crummy line there.
Huh?
You're getting a lot of static on your line.
Really?
Yeah.
Still?
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'll try you back then.
Okay, because I'd be interested. What's that?
I'll try you back then.
Okay, well, I'd love to talk to you.
Okay.
WFMU, you're on the air. FMU, you're on the air. No. WFMU, you're on the air.
Oh, you did it.
What did I do? Is this Chris?
Yeah.
I'm going to try to make this love connection happen, my friend.
Now, did you end up dropping Linda's line?
Yes.
I could try calling back on the other line. She just gave up. Bronwyn wouldn't have these problems.
Oh, Bronwyn wouldn't have these problems, would she? Hey, you know what else Bronwyn wouldn't do?
She'd really dick.
She wouldn't hang up on you. Get off my phone. You're banned. Chris, I'm pulling the plug on this date. Okay, let's get the FMU. You're on the air.
Hey, it's Linda.
Hey, Linda.
So what happened?
The phones aren't going so hot here. I'm trying to get your little friend back on the air.
Oh, I thought you just hung up on him.
You know what you do? What? Linda, you email me your email address.
Okay.
Chris, you email me your email address. I'm going to make this happen. I got to get the phones in working order, though, first.
Okay.
I apologize.
All right, I'll email you right now.
Yes, please do that. And Chris, please do the same. You're not banned.
It's Tom at WFMU.org.
That's correct.
Okay.
All right, thanks.
Okay, bye.
FMU, you're on the air.
Tom?
Yes?
Does this sound better?
Yes, that's better. Thank you.
Okay, great. Well, my name is Paul Crenshaw.
Okay.
And I just don't care anymore.
Uh-huh.
So, no, I'm just going to give my name out.
And, okay.
For the benefit of the listeners, I guess I'll briefly recap my situation. Earlier this year, back in the spring, to be specific,
mm-hmm.
I was promoted at my job to the position of office manager, supervisor. And that's it. That was in the wake of numerous layoffs at our company, in which a lot of people lost their jobs. Obviously, the office manager supervisor that was in the position before me lost his job. Therefore, I was instead of losing my job, I was promoted into this position to where I was overseeing my what was once my peers.
Okay.
My other people that I worked next to.
Mm-hmm.
I as you know, Tom, I wish I had lost my job, because the situation got very, very unsavory for me at work.
Mm-hmm.
There was a lot of jealousy, and they were just not treating me with any degree of respect. I was dealing with some very horrible situations at work, and these are people that are supposed to be my charges.
Mm-hmm.
And I just didn't know where to turn, so that's why I initially called you.
Yeah,
things really haven't gotten any better.
Okay.
And go ahead. I'm sorry.
You had basically called and said when you got promoted, things got ugly real fast.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes. Like I had employees. Oh, well, a male employee shows up to work without a shirt on.
Uh-huh. Now this is at an office.
This is in a corporate environment. Yes.
Yeah. Where that? I mean, this is not you running a landscaping business or.
Exactly.
Something.
That's a clear disregard of a dress code. And
okay.
when I say something to him, he just thrust his body at me in that kind of back and forth motion, like I guess that's what you do if you're about to start a fight in a pub.
Mm-hmm.
And he's thrusting at me and telling me to bring it on.
Okay.
But, and my, all of this has had a really bad effect on my family, and my wife and children have actually left me.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry to hear that.
And I now live by myself. It's just that now they're just playing with my mind at work.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I'm still their boss. I didn't ever know who to turn to. They told me that I would be subject to physical harm if I was to tell on them to our regional manager, or to even call the police. I was told that some people would be waiting for me in the parking garage with bicycle chains and ski masks. They would be waiting for me. They would be hiding under my SUV as I tried to go home if I escalated the situation.
So you were just openly threatened, point blank threats to where it's unmistakable what they were getting.
It really is, and these people are not barbaric or stupid. These people are these people are my contemporaries. These are smart people that are just trying to undermine my authority. Mm-hmm. And I thought that I would have good ideas around the office, just to bring morale up around the office, and they would turn those kind of things on their heads, just to where it was some horror show, on a Friday afternoon when everybody's supposed to be loosening up for the weekend. It's some just ridiculous, surreal, I don't know, I try to have like Hawaiian Day, where people dress up in a Hawaiian outfits and bring it was a potluck.
Uh-huh.
And, and then this one guy goes to a McDonald's and buys 6 Big Macs and puts them into a blender and liquefies them, pours these Big Macs into a casserole dish and brings that as his potluck dish, and then they forced me to eat it in front of the entire office.
Oh, that's sickening. You had mentioned that, and that still is just.
But I think the cruelty, the physical cruelty has somewhat subsided in favor of just these subversive jabs, and they're tearing me apart, and I don't know. They all know that my wife left me.
Okay.
And they know, they know what they're doing to me. They know that now, since my wife left me, I am now single, and I had a female office employee approach me about going on a date.
Okay.
With her. She said she had 2 free tickets to the premiere of K-PAX.
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, sure. I'm just a sucker for this type of thing. I'm a pushover. I don't see it coming when it's coming.
Okay, so it seems like a pretty common. It seems like, right, a nice gesture.
It did. So I went and I picked her up from her house, and we are going to the movie theater. We arrive, and we both sit down in the movie theater, and she gets up to use the restroom during the previews,
mm-hmm,
before the movie had even started, and she never came back.
Okay.
So I sit through K-PAX, and as I'm exiting the theater, she's coming out of Serendipity, and she looks at me and she says, "So how was it?"
So wait, so she asks you to a movie, and then she just walks into what, another theater and watches a different movie?
That's correct, Tom.
See, that's just.
And they were all laughing about it at the office the next day.
The fact, so you think it was actually like a setup?
Oh, like, I mean, yes, it's another idea I had around the office. This is the last time I'm ever doing anything like this for these people. What I'm about to mention to you.
Okay.
I keep thinking that, if I give, then it will be appreciated, and then the office will be happy, and then I won't be subjected to any more of this. But that's not the case.
It seems like you're talking about a vaguely uphill battle. It seems like you're not making any ground on getting them on your side.
I did get a merit increase. I did get a raise. I got a raise to 21.5.
Uh-huh. You had mentioned that, and
I didn't know that I was going to get it yet. My boss said that.
Oh, you
I was in the works for a raise to 21.5.
Oh, that's right. You mentioned the raise was and like
a half price Sam's Club membership. Yes, and I did get those things. So there, you know, things softened out a little bit there.
Uh-huh. So, but that couldn't have helped. That's not a worthwhile exchange for your family, having lost your family due to these conditions.
You're telling me. So I decide, well, I'll go over here to Corky's Barbecue, and I'll buy, you know, several trays of barbecue ribs and baked beans and sandwich makings, and I will I'll bring them into the break room, and I'll uncover them, and then I will I'll come into the main work area, and I'll announce that there's a free barbecue lunch today in the break room, just for you guys, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Just for you,
like,
guys,
like courtesy of you.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. I that makes, I mean, that it, you're it's not for lack of trying. So.
I know. I don't.
So
I don't know.
So they went.
So the first woman that had entered the break room, she just went running and screaming into the break room. You know, like I might as well have told the woman that there was, you know, 1,000 Beanie Babies waiting on her in there.
Uh huh.
She comes back and says, you know, she says, "Well, Paul, that's real funny of you, but there's nothing in there. That's a real funny joke, Paul."
But you had put the food there.
Exactly, yes. So I walked in there, and somebody had stolen all of the food.
Uh-huh.
And not 2 hours later, as we're sulking around the office, you know,
uh-huh.
I mean, I look like some kind of a jackass for just, I don't know.
Because now it looks like you were trying to pull one over on them.
Right. So 2 hours later, 3 hours later, these flyers start to appear around the break room in the bathrooms. It say, "Barbecue cookout this weekend at Dan's."
Uh-huh.
"Everyone's invited except Paul."
No, when you say "except Paul,"
that's me.
Yeah, that's you, but it didn't. It said that actually on the flyer?
That's correct.
So you were actually singled out.
Well, the barbecue was obviously stolen.
Uh-huh.
And then we'll be the party favors at this man's weekend barbecue.
Yeah.
Now.
So you bought all this barbecue that now everyone will eat at Dan's house.
Without me.
So
yeah,
how...
That's what happens in... That's what happens in my, you know, that's a day-to-day thing almost for me.
Now, how do
you know, the next Monday, I come to work, and Janet comes up to me, and she pats me on the shoulder, and she says, you know, "I know you had a bad Friday, and probably a fairly uneventful weekend, and, you know, I guess she's allowed to patronize me. I mean, she's right. That's what happened. She's correct."
Mm-hmm.
So she says to me, "I'll go into the break room, and I'll fix you a bowl of cereal. You know,
okay.
We're all going to the cafeteria rather, and
I'll
fix you a bowl of cereal, and I'll bring it to you." And I thought, you know, that's really nice. You know, that's a way to maybe cheer my Monday up a little bit.
Uh huh.
And she comes back to my desk, and she has a bowl of chocolate milk with Andy Capp's hot fries floating in it.
You mean like the prefab, like those?
A bowl of chocolate milk with Andy Capp's hot fries floating in it. This is the cereal that this woman thought, you know.
Yeah, well, that's not edible.
Well, no, it's not. It's also not very nice.
No, so she was just mocking you openly?
Yes.
I mean, obviously she was.
Yes.
So
yes.
Now
I'm at the office right now. I mean, I'm working late. I have to work late. Nobody else does the work. I'm the only one around here that does any of the work.
So
you know, I'm the one that hears about it because of these people's
behavior, and these people just, they're completely just insubordinate nature of this workplace.
So how
gets done unless I do it.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like that's how it's been for a while now. So how
that's
did you
correct.
Handle that situation with the fries? I mean, the floating in the chocolate milk.
I started to weep at my desk.
So you just kind of lost it.
Yes.
So.
And then later, you know, later the same day, everybody was like, "Hey, Paul, we're all. Would you like to go to lunch with us?"
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, sure. Okay. Well, we're all meeting at Food Avenue, which is, I don't know if you know this or not, but it's the restaurant inside of the Target.
Okay.
Food
sure.
Avenue.
Yeah.
And we're all meeting at Food Avenue. Of course, I go there, and there's nobody. Nobody ever shows up, so I'm left to sit in Food Avenue for an hour.
Waiting for everyone eating, to join you.
That's eating spicy fries, yes.
Uh-huh.
And waiting for everybody else to join me, yes.
So, well, and when was that?
This was earlier this week.
So I can't tell you...
Do you have any advice for me? I mean,
I do. I mean, again, you have to get out of there.
I don't know what to do though. The job market is a war zone right now.
It really is. Yes, but I mean, I actually think you'd be better off. Don't you think you'd be better off?
What, collecting unemployment?
You know, not collecting unemployment, but at least. You don't think you'd be better off even if all you had was a job, you know, making hamburgers or something, and you worked to get your family back? I mean, don't you value your family?
The benefits are just so good here, though.
It doesn't sound like they're that. What, the Sam's Club membership?
Yeah, well, I get half off at Hula Hands, too.
But how much, at what point is your life worth it, though?
Well, I guess that's just something I'm going to have to evaluate myself. I don't know. It's just the way they've changed this whole game around, and it's more subtle now. It's ripping me apart, you know. It's like another woman asked me on a date.
Uh-huh.
Another woman did.
So they're just kind of openly mocking you now on some
yeah,
level.
Yeah, it's much more subtle. It's not, you know, no longer are they sticking a stun gun to my neck and forcing
uh-huh.
me to eat a liquefied Big Mac casserole in front of the entire office while tears stream down my face.
Uh-huh.
No longer is it that. Now it's much more subtle and underhanded, and therefore much more effective.
Yeah, well, you have to... You have to stick up for yourself.
I don't really know how to do that. I just, you know.
I mean, it's
I think these
quit,
you know,
quit your job. How can you let yourself as an adult, as like a human being, get treated like that? I mean, doesn't it just hurt you like to the core of who you are?
Tremendously.
Well, I would say that nothing is worth that price then.
I know. I just, they keep luring me in. I mean, the continued prospect of maybe one of these women in the office actually does want to date me. I mean, I don't have a family anymore. My wife left me.
You couldn't get your family back? You don't think they would take you back?
I was just this job has made me such a mess. I mean, I don't know if I'm appropriate to live with.
Well, I think you might be thinking that way because you're so incredibly... Just you've let yourself be damaged to this point.
Well, I guess you're right.
It might just feel like you're that bad when you're not. I mean, you're just... Stick up for yourself.
I mean, when does it
It seems like it's never going to end.
You're right. Last night, you know, I went on a date with another woman just last night.
Uh-huh.
From the office. And we get to the restaurant, the Fox and the Hound Grill, and I'm in the middle of a conversation. I'm in the middle of speaking at the table to her. We had just sat down previously, 5 minutes. And she gets a pair of headphones out of her purse and puts them on.
Uh-huh.
And starts listening to music, and she does that through the remainder of the meal.
And you just sat there?
Yes.
And put up with it?
Yes.
But I think you're part of the problem on some level, is that they've got your number, and you let them keep getting it again and again. Why don't you get them back somehow? Have you thought about that?
I really should.
I mean, like, why don't you get them back? Why don't you call them on their... If you're not going to do the smart thing and quit the job, which I think is by far the smart thing, why don't you take them up on their own challenge, and why don't you say bring it on?
Maybe you're right, Tom.
I mean, why don't you go after them then? I mean, I don't know what to... If you're not going to quit, that's the only thing I can think.
Maybe you're right. I mean, Well, really, I've already lost everything. What else have I got to lose?
I think... Obviously, I'm telling you, quit the job first.
I'm afraid.
But if you're so afraid to quit the job, then why don't you draw a line in the sand and start sticking up for yourself within those parameters?
That sounds like the plan for me. That sounds like the plan. I like that idea, Tom.
Play the game by their rules and see how they like it.
I like that idea. That sounds good.
You know, why don't you ask someone on a date there, and then if they turn you down, then you... I don't know. I mean, what could you... I don't know what you could even do. I mean, you get them fired or something? You play down and dirty.
I think you've got it.
I don't know. I mean, again, I'm not telling you. That's only if you're staying at the job, which I don't think is a good idea at all.
Yeah. Well, I'm at the job now. I mean, it's what is it? It's 8:30 here.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, I'm still up here finishing work.
Uh-huh.
The work never ends. I don't really know how I'm going to have time to plan any kind of retaliation. Hold on.
Is that a personal phone call? Huh?
Yeah, what?
I think it's about time you got off your personal phone call, huh? I think it's about time.
Paul? Well, I did not hang up on him. I know everyone thinks I'm trigger happy. I was not trigger happy that time. That was not me hanging up on Paul. And please call back if you're listening, Paul. That's part of Open Phone Tuesday. I mean, it's look, the good thing about making the best show on WFMU an open-ended show, I guess, we can talk about anything as it comes up. And, that might not have been the most... I mean, I feel depressed from that phone call, but, he needs help. And, I think it's worthwhile to help somebody. The phone number, 201-200-9368. We just got an email in... Someone saying, Tom, if this guy is telling the truth, then he has to leave that job. No job is worth his sanity. These people he works with are pigs, my God. At the very least, tell him to get some help. Doesn't his company have a harassment department? Which is just shot. I agree with you 100%, emailer/listener. Why don't we get back to the music? Here's something
Here's something from the Chrome Cranks on WFMU.
What are you doing in the bathroom getting drunk, Timmy?
I'm waiting for Miss Lori. She's gonna teach me something in here.
Thank you.
Hey, everybody. You're listening to WFMU East Orange, WXHD Mount Hope Worldwide on the World Wide Web and beyond. At WFMU.org. My name is Tom Scharpling here, checking in with you. Only another 1 hour and 16 minutes to go in the show tonight. I got an email from Chris and an email from Linda. The two lovebirds looking to make a love connection on the best show in WFMU. I will make that happen. Once I get the phones in order, up and running, that will happen at a future date. I promise both of you lovebirds, potentially, that I will hook you up royally. Hey, did you know the music we just heard? No, I don't know the music we just heard. Well, let me tell you what we heard. Yeah, that's a good idea. Why don't you tell me what we just heard? Okay, I will. Okay, I'm waiting. Okay, I'm about to tell you. Okay, we'll get to it. I'll get to it right now. Go ahead, what are you waiting for? Actually, I'm waiting for you to shut up. Well, if you'd shut up, you could back announce the music. Ah, back announce, eh? You know the DJ lingo. Ah, you don't sound like much of a DJ, stammering over your own voice there. Yeah, well, that wasn't too slick what you just said there. Well, I'm not a DJ. Back announce the music. Okay, I will. Hey, we heard the Cheater Slicks from their 2-CD set on the In the Red label. Forgive thee the name of the set we heard. Arm Yourself, which came out a couple years ago on the fantastic Cheater Slicks franchisees. The Clone Defects checking in. From their album Blood on Jupiter, we heard Little Ms. Laurie. Ah, the Scientists put out a record called Absolute, the Greatest Hits Collection. And we heard Swampland from said collection. And starting us off at the beginning of the set, the Chrome Cranks from their self-titled record from 1994. We heard Dark Room, which was actually a 7-inch that the band put out, but now part of a compact disky. Tripping over my own words tonight, so excuse me. Hey, the phone number, 201-200-9368. It's Open Phone Tuesday. I was looking tonight to talk to anyone who was at the record fair and had some fun, had some exciting tales to regale us with. Any record that you found that you were looking for 10 years, did you find it? Did you meet anybody exciting at the record fair? Now's the time. Let's do a little post-record fair wrap-up. And you can call and talk about who you voted for today if you want, because we had the big election. Apparently, Jim McGreevy has been called the winner in New Jersey, according to CBS. And, of course, we could talk about the New York Yankees going to the toilet in the 9th inning of Game 7 of the World Series. They bombed, and they bombed hard. I'll talk to Yankee fans or Yankee haters. Did you laugh when they lost? Did you find it hilarious? Did you mock your buddy at work? Are you sad that they lost? Are you mad that these Met fans, who didn't even go to the playoffs, seem to be getting all juiced about rubbing it in your face? Your team went to Game 7. Last inning of the last game of the playoffs, World Series, and they lost going down fighting, and other fans of teams who didn't even make it into the postseason mock you as if their team is somehow superior. Does that irk you? I'll talk to both sides of that issue. Or a fourth option. We'll talk about anything you want because it is Open Phone Tuesday. And the email address, toms@wfmu.org. That's the number, that's the email address to get in touch with me. You write your email, I'll read the email. So at the record fair, I'm trying to think of what I found that was exciting. There was a table that shall remain nameless. I bought they had something set up. It was like a shell game, like a sting operation with a little robot on the table. I shan't name who they are. Where you paid $1 and you got something from inside the robot, a present, so to speak. And actually, you know what? It was actually a good deal, I have to say. For $1, what I got was worth it. When I paid these merchants the $1 inside the robot, there was a chocolate bar. And inside the chocolate bar was, of all things, if you believe this, a golden ticket. And my nephew, Augustus Gloop, when he saw that golden ticket, oh, you should have seen his eyes light up. He's a very sloppy kid. So I will be taking him to the great Mr. Wonka's chocolate factory, of course, and so that we can get inside and see how things work. Get ready, Augustus. Your Uncle Tommy's taking you. FMU, you're on the air.
Hey, Tom. Yeah? I'd like to ask you a question about some of the music that you play on the radio.
Hey, can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Where are you from?
I'm from New York City.
New York City, what, the alternate universe of New York City?
No, I live right on 6th Avenue.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And on 6th Avenue. Hey, isn't that where that voice school that went out of business is located?
What are you talking about? I just want to ask you some questions.
There was
music that you play on the radio there.
There was
WFMU.
There was a voice school that went out of business because it was Time Magazine wrote an article saying it was the worst voice impression school.
I just want to know why you don't play any Led Zeppelin on your show. That's all.
Hey, how old are you really?
What?
How old are you?
How old am I?
Yeah.
I'm 63, Tom.
How old?
63.
You're 63.
Yes, sir.
Oh, this is just horrifying, this phone call. This is just the worst phone call I've ever had. Congratulations for doing you, whoever you are, for doing the worst phone call in the history of radio.
I'm so proud of myself. Yes, thank you, Tom. Thank you so much.
You shouldn't be proud, though.
I'm so happy.
You should be ashamed. Go look in the mirror.
What?
Go look in the mirror right now. Is there a mirror in your apartment?
Right here.
What street do you live on again?
I live on 6th Avenue.
And what?
23rd Street.
6th Avenue and 23rd Street,
yes,
really?
Sir.
Hey, any record stores in that area?
Yes, sir.
What?
What?
Well, name one of them.
There's Virgin Record Stores down by Times Square.
Well, around 6th Avenue and 23rd Street, is there like any cool record store in that area?
Do I sound like I go to cool record stores down there?
Hey, is there any,
What?
Where's the closest movie theater?
I don't know.
Why is that? Because it sounds like you don't go to the movies that often.
I don't go to the movies that much at all.
Get off my phone! How dare you? WFMU, you're on the air.
Hi, Tom. Yes, I went to the record...
Oh, stop with the fake voices, please.
What fake voice?
Please, do your real voice, sir.
Oh, this is my real voice.
Oh, how dumb do you think I am?
Well, all I wanted to do was just say I really enjoyed the $2 grab bag I got.
I bought one as well. I was very excited by it.
Yes. And also, you beat me very badly in foosball.
Did I beat you at foosball? I was playing people at the record fair in foosball.
Yes.
And we were playing the first one to three.
Uh-huh.
Won the game. And I went for the weekend 33-3.
Yes.
So
well,
for the 30...
Me, you did shut me out, sir.
The 36 games I played, I lost three of them.
Yes.
Of those three,
yes,
one of them was lost by somebody that I had just beaten. I beat somebody and they wanted a rematch and they came back and beat me 3-2.
Oh, wow.
The second game, I lost the other two games back-to-back.
Uh-huh.
By two people who I think were cheating.
I see.
Todd O'Phonic Todd.
Oh, man.
And Mike Lupica.
Oh, man.
I think they were cheating somehow.
I think you should have gave him a good Swiss kick in the family jewels.
You think so?
Yeah.
Hey, so what did you find at the record fair?
I found a really cool album by Die Cruisin'.
Uh-huh.
Actually, I picked up At Your Table with Terry Dean.
Okay, we can't talk about that, though.
Oh, I'm sorry, sorry.
All right. Anything else? Anything else cool?
Let's see. What else did I pick up? I picked up a two-hour compilation of Marvel Comics video cartoons.
Really?
The old stuff with The Incredible Hulk and Iron Man and stuff like that.
That
was pretty cool.
Sing one of the songs for us from that. Sing the Hulk song.
Oh, the Dark Bruce Banner, belted by gamma rays, turns into the Hulk. I forget the rest.
Ain't he what? What is he? Ain't he...
Unglamorous.
Ain't he unglamorous?
Yes. And that's what I... Excuse me?
That's the first thing that pops into my head when I see a... How tall is the Hulk? 7 foot?
Yeah, but in the cartoon, in the opening bit of the cartoon, he's like about 20 feet tall or so.
Yeah. Boy, isn't he unglamorous.
Yes, exactly.
You know what words would pop into my mind this time? Horrifying. Terrifying.
Mm-hmm.
Frightening.
Yeah.
Unglamorous.
Who would have thought of it?
Who made that rhyme up? Come on. That was probably Stan Lee.
Exactly.
So did you watch the videotape?
Oh, yeah, I watched all of it.
And did you enjoy it?
Oh, yeah.
Did it bring back memories?
Yeah, it did, of
TV
tonsillectomies
picks?
And chicken pox and all that stuff.
Did you play TV picks at that time? Did it bring back memories of TV picks?
I think I did. Once, I lost really badly.
What game did you play?
The football game.
Well, that was the hardest one of all.
Yeah, of course, I'd have to take it all, like, sick with my tonsils out and everything.
Do you know what the easiest one of all was?
The tic-tac-toe.
I thought the spaceships was the easiest.
Oh, a spaceship?
Because all it was like a target, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the kids who got the football one, they would go like this. Picks!
Yeah.
Picks! And the football would, like, throw, like, way too early.
Exactly.
And then, like, the kids with the space one would just go, picks, and, like, the thing would just shoot constantly and would hit every ship that passed the little crosshairs.
Yeah. Anyway, I also picked up some really cool Hype to Death stuff.
Uh-huh.
And hopefully I'll be getting a catalog soon from the guys, you know, with further merchandise that they have that they weren't there. So that's going to be really cool.
That should be good. Now, on a scale of 1 to 10,
yeah,
what do you give the fall 2001 WFMU record fair?
A 25.
A 25 out of a scale of 1 to 10. That is unheard of, but you know what? It's not surprising, because that's how good the record fair
is. And the Two Boost Pizza was really great, and the beer, well, that's what did me in with the foosball. I think I had a few too many beers.
Yeah, blame it on the beer.
Well, I took mass transit, so I didn't have to drive back and forth.
Well, that's good, but don't
blame. By the way,
yeah,
Bill, you know, I live up here in upstate New York, and, you know, driving down, they have a shuttle to make it to New York City, but they don't have a shuttle coming back, so worth anybody who travels around back and forth from, like, the Hudson Valley region to New York City. They don't have a shuttle coming back, and we drove all the way from Route 17 from Giants Stadium all the way up to where I live up here in Middletown, and that That wasn't fun.
Not fun. But you know what? It was worth it, though, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, but only now am I really starting to listen to all the booty I got, all the merchandise, so.
Will you savor it?
Oh, I will.
Well, I appreciate you calling.
Okay, thank you very much.
Well, thanks. You have a good night.
You too now. Bye.
Okay, bye. 201-200-9368 is the number to call. WFMU East Orange, WXHD Mount Hope Worldwide on the World Wide Web at WFMU.org. Another satisfied Record Fair customer. Not surprising. Just got an email here from Portland, Oregon. I listen to you via the internet, Tom. The Yankees kick butt. Game 7 was a joke. The Yankees will be back next year. The D-backs won't even make the playoffs. That was Nate from Portland, Oregon, checking in. Nate emailed Thomas at WFMU.org. Smart move. Oh, it's fun times. I had fun at the record fair. It was good seeing all the people when I played foosball against them. It was good routing them one by one. Sitting them down after they had the courage to stand up. Now getting back to the Yankees. There's things that you could not like about them. It's obvious what you wouldn't like about them. That they win too much. People hate winning. I guess I hate winning. That's why I became uncomfortable rooting for them. To some degree. But now to Met fans, are Met fans on the other side? It's like, you know, Yankee fans are bad winners. I mean, are they so accustomed to winning that they think it's just second nature? And conversely, are Met fans just like, are they just like lifetime losers? Like, are they just doomed to just be on get the short end of the stick year in and year out? You notice how a lot of Met fans also are Jets fans? And a lot of Yankees fans are Giants fans. What is it about people that attracts them to doomed franchises like that in sports? Is it that they always want the underdog? They always want to be pulling for the little guy? And that the big guy is just, they see that as being like rooting for Ford or General Motors. Or is it that they just have some weird character flaw where they can't allow themselves to pick a winner? What is it? I'm trying to do to get to the bottom of this. FMU, you're on the air.
Hey, I want to talk about the Yankees.
Okay.
You're going on about them.
Now, what's your name, first of all?
My name is Paul, not the Paul who called earlier.
Okay.
Another one.
All right.
I just want to say, I'm a big Mets fan.
First of all, can I just say stop with the fake voices?
Well, I apologize. You know, is this
your real voice?
No. You know, it's kind of like, you ever like have your parents tell you to stop making that face?
Uh-huh.
Freeze like that.
Mm-hmm.
I did that with my voice, and now my voice is stuck like this, and I can't get back to my real voice.
I did the same thing, except it was with, they said, stop cutting your hair like that,
uh-huh.
Or it will stay that way forever.
And
you know, it did.
And it did. Stop growing.
You know what my hair looks like now?
No.
Do you know who Paul Williams is?
Paul, is he an actor?
Actor slash musician.
Mm-hmm.
He was in Smokey and the Bandit, 1 and 2. He played,
Little Cletus?
Yeah, not really ringing a bell.
Hey, maybe this will help you remember. We gotta get that beer to the fair, Daddy. I'll bet you that the bandit could get that beer to the fair, Daddy.
Does that sound familiar?
No, not really.
How about this? Turn left, Daddy. Turn right, Daddy. We'll be in the clear.
Does that sound familiar?
Okay.
Well, that's Jackie Gleason, so that doesn't apply, really.
All right, well, that's probably why it was, you know.
How about this line?
Mm-hmm.
You know when I became a racer is my father worked all his life in a coal mine. Let me finish, please.
All right.
Worked all his life in a coal mine, had big plans. He's going to buy himself a boat, go fishing, tell my mother lies. 3 days before he retired, he died. And right then and there, I decided I was going to go for it. Each and every day, no matter what, I was going to go for it. Does that ring a bell?
Not really.
Well, it shouldn't, because that was Burt Reynolds in Cannonball Run 1.
Oh, the first Cannonball Run.
That was him explaining to Farrah Fawcett why they were doing this race. Because they threw her in the back of the ambulance that was posing as a... They're posing as an ambulance bringing a patient cross-country for an emergency operation,
mm-hmm.
right? And Farrah Fawcett ended up in the thing, and she thought she was being kidnapped. And Burt Reynolds, do you remember what he said to her when she thought something funny might go on?
No, I don't really remember that exactly.
He said, don't worry, nothing's going to go on. We're racers, not rapists. And then...
That's not too bad.
Then there was, remember, dun, dun, dun. Remember that?
None of this is that really, was, no. I'm sorry.
Ooh, JJ! JJ, what are we going to do?
No.
You don't remember any of this?
I don't think I've actually ever seen a movie Burt Reynolds has been in. Except I saw Boogie Nights.
Do you remember that villain, Mr. Foyt, who was trying to shut down the Cannonballers?
No. That
guy was a jerk. But you know what they did to him?
No.
They got him.
Yeah.
It was so great when they got him. I remember there was this one scene where...
Did you kind of think they weren't going to get him, and at the end they did?
I thought that he was going to get all of them and have them thrown in jail forever.
Mm-hmm.
You know what the shocking thing about Cannonball 1 was?
What's that?
Who won the race? Do you remember who won?
I can't say I did, no.
Well, you see, it was going to be Captain K... Was it Captain Chaos? I think that's what Dom DeLuise had this altered, he had this split personality where he was a superhero. He thought he was a...
Not a double role, but like, just a split person, same character.
Because all of a sudden he always talked about him.
Oh,
ooh,
okay.
JJ, I wonder if him will show up. What if him shows up? Will you shut up about him? You remember that part?
No.
Remember how Burt Reynolds did that laugh? And
no.
Then,
no.
So then it looked like it was going to be Captain Chaos was going to win the race, and he was running with the ticket to go punch it at the thing, and all of a sudden some woman yelled, "Help, my baby's drowning!" "Never fear, madam! Captain Chaos is here to save the day! Dun, dun, dun!" And he jumped in the water. And then JJ, which is Burt Reynolds' character, he goes, "You idiot! What's he doing?" He was slapping him, like when he got out of the... Because he saved a dog. It turned out it was a dog in the water. And then you know who won the race? It was, I'm going to leave it wide open. Let's see if any of the listeners remember who the race is. Let's get back to your story, though, anyway.
Yeah.
So you were talking about Cannonball Run and how it impacted upon you as a youth. Go on.
I did kind of forget. Yeah. Is that what we were talking about?
I think that, yes. I think that was the topic. Now what? Now you were actually talking about, The Yankees.
Oh, the Yankees, yes, that's correct.
Okay.
So I'm a big Met fan.
Uh-huh.
And I have to say that watching, the game on Sunday was just, it was glorious. I loved it.
So you just take pleasure, did you take pleasure from the fact that the Diamondbacks won, or the fact that, like, Yankee fans were just miserable?
I would say a little of both. Because, as you'd mentioned earlier, I think the Yankee fans are bad winners.
And do you think the Met fans are, like, way too comfortable losing every year?
Yeah, you might be correct, yeah.
Is there, like, a loser's streak amongst Met fans?
I think Mets fans have a bigger tendency to root for the underdog.
Because there's nothing more sad than when some, like, Met fan is arguing with a Yankee fan. It's like a little kid arguing with an adult.
Yeah.
Because then they're just like, yeah, Mets are coming back, man. We're going to show you. And then the Yankee fan's like, hey, we won the World Series. What are you going to do? Yeah, you look at Clemens. He's not even a Yankee.
Yeah, I think
and it's like, hey, we won the World Series. What are you going to do?
I think I've had that conversation, actually. But, I mean, I'm a big Mets fan. You can't really, explain sports allegiances. Mm-hmm. It's just you like the team or you don't,
Mm-hmm.
And I like the Mets, so by default, I hate the Yankees.
Are you a big Bob Murphy fan?
I wouldn't say I'm a big fan. When he goes into his coughing fits, it gets a bit much.
You mean when he goes like this, when he's like, my favorite name that he always said was, Jose Vizcaino. That was my favorite name that he would say. Jose Vizcaino.
Yeah.
So I was sad when the Mets traded him. But then when he would be doing the game, he'd be like, Alfonso.
Now, I remember in the first game of this season, actually, mm-hmm. I think the Mets were playing the Braves, and hope hadn't been vanquished yet because it was the first game of the season.
Yeah.
And,
yes.
Robin Ventura hit that big home run to give the Mets the lead against John Rocker, or something, when he was still on the Braves. So
yeah.
It was a big moment, so you just heard, Murphy saying, long drive deep, and then about a 5-second pause.
He blew the call.
He blew the call.
A lot of times he also would hit this weird, like, dry patch in his voice.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden he'd be like, Ventura with the hit, it's a long run. Like, it would just, like, his voice would just dry out.
Well, but the guy's a Hall of Fame announcer, I guess he can retire when he feels
a Hall of Fame announcer. Oh, God forbid I ever visit that Hall of Fame. Boy, hey, let me take my family to the Announcers Hall of Fame.
Well,
son, you see that right there? That is the greatest announcer of them all. That is a statue of Howard Cosell. Yeah, yes, that's right. That's why we drove halfway across the country, is to look at the retired yellow jacket that he wore in the Monday Night Football booth. Oh, wow, can you look at that? Hey, son, that's Vin Scully right there. That's a portrait of Vin Scully. The Announcer Hall of Fame. Oh, what a sad hall.
Well, I think
the saddest hall of all.
I think it's probably a wing of the Individual Sports Hall of Fame.
Oh, the Sports Hall of Fame.
Yeah, it might be a wing of the Baseball Hall of Fame.
Is there actually an announcer's section in the Baseball Hall of Fame?
Phil Rizzuto was inducted into the Announcer's Hall of Fame a couple of years ago, right? He never made it as a player, but he made it as an announcer.
Boy, that's an accomplishment.
It really is.
An announcer.
I think it's just, if you're just on the air long enough, they just give it to you.
That's like making it to the Walmart District Manager's Hall of Fame. It's like, wow, that's the Hall of Fame for all the guys who supervised purchasing for the whole Eastern Seaboard for Walmart when they were looking to open up in the Northeast. That's a guy right there. That guy right there, Len Robertson was the one. Boy, he's a Hall of Fame buyer.
Well, he did a good job for the people.
What Hall of Fame would you be in, my friend, if there was a Hall of Fame?
I really don't know at this point. I would hate to toot my own horn.
You know what Hall of Fame? Well, if you can toot your own horn, then you could be in a Hall of Fame.
The horn tooting Hall of Fame?
Yes.
Yeah.
You know what Hall of Fame I would be in?
What's that?
The Hall of Fame Hall of Fame.
Just the best of all Hall of Fames, just condensed into one.
For the best discussion of Hall of Fames, I would be in that Hall of Fame.
Well, I think tonight may have cinched it for you.
You think tonight is?
I think so.
So I should submit this show to the Hall of Fame Hall of Fame.
No doubt about it.
Do you think this will get me into the Hall of Halls?
If this doesn't, I don't know what possibly could.
Do you call it the Hall of Halls?
I think you could do that, you have to have the fame in there somehow, because otherwise it's just a hall, otherwise.
Now, how about the Hall of Shame? What Hall of Shame would you be in?
Tom, you're really putting me on the spot here. Probably,
What's your biggest vice?
My biggest, probably following the Mets through season after season might be my biggest vice.
So you have like a loserly streak in you?
I believe so, yes.
Mm-hmm. Do you root for the Jets?
See, I'm not a football fan. I watch football. I don't really follow it.
Uh-huh. Now, every year, do you just feel like the? Do you just feel like with the Mets? Do you ever really, honestly believe that this is going to be the year?
Well, yeah. Well, not this year, but you know, the past couple of years. But it always seems like, you know, well, somebody said about Johnny Thunders once that they always managed to snatch defeat from the jaws of victory.
Yeah.
And that's pretty much the Mets story. You know.
Well. I guess it's you know, it's like whether you want to be a grown-up, you know, like all the bad things about being a grown-up,
mm-hmm.
you know, just like you're always, like grown-ups are always right, and grown-ups are, you know, whether you want that or you want to be a, you know, like a kid who is always, you know, getting what fur from the opposition in the end. Well, you know what, my friend?
Yes.
You have, you know what hall you should go in?
What hall is that?
The momentum-killing Hall of Fame. The phones have died since you got on the phone.
Well, I apologize.
I accept your apology, and I will hang up on you.
Oh, can I?
As soon as you start saying something so that I can leave you hanging in the middle of the void. WFMU is the station. 201-200-9368 is the number. It's Open Phone Tuesday, as it is every Tuesday. Who out there knows who won the race in the first Cannonball Run? I know. Does anybody know? 201-200-9368. I will give you this hint. You ready? For this hint, it was not Bert Convy with his high-powered motorcycle. No, not Bert Convy. One more hint. It was not Jackie Chan. It was not Jackie Chan. And I'll give you one other hint. It was not. I repeat, not. Jamie Farr as the Sheik. From some amorphous country. FMU, you're on the air.
Hi, Tom.
Hey.
It was one of the females that won, and I think it was... it was either Farrah Fawcett or it was Adrienne Barbeau. It was one of them.
You're close.
I think it was Adrienne Barbeau.
You're half right. Who was she paired with, though?
Oh, boy.
I need both.
It was her, maybe Jackie Chan.
No.
Because Jackie Chan's in that movie.
But he didn't win.
It was her. She won the race.
With who?
Well, she was with Farrah Fawcett the whole time.
No, she wasn't.
I don't know.
You know nothing about Cannonball Run. How dare you come on this program?
All right, she was paired with... Oh, boy. I haven't seen that movie in a long time. Can you give me a hint?
No. Either you knows it or you don't know it.
I'd say it's... All right, she... Oh, you're right, because Farrah Fawcett was, as you said earlier, was...
She was in with JJ.
Okay. Shoot. I don't know. I'm stumped.
Well, you know what that means. You get flushed. That would have only worked if I had a flush sound effect. Like the hit... That's what I gotta get, is a flush sound effect. Hey, Dave?
Yeah?
Can you check the CDs, and the sound effect CDs, and see if there's a sound effect CD with a toilet flushing on it? Because from now on, I'm flushing callers when I hang up on them. FMU, you're on the air.
Hi, I've just been waiting online.
Well, you're on the air right now.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
Oh, great, I just turned off the phone.
Fantastic.
Or the radio.
Welcome to the program.
Hi, Tom.
How are you?
I love your show.
Oh, thanks.
And I have a Cannonball Run answer.
Okay.
Or a tentative answer.
Who is it? Who won the race?
I don't know what the hell her name was. It was the blonde who had on the skin-tight blue suit.
Of course it was.
Adrienne Barbeau's,
but who was that?
Shotgun rider. I don't know.
Come on.
She wasn't a celebrity, was she?
Yeah, she was.
No.
Yeah, she was.
Sorry, I don't know, man.
I don't know what to tell you. You got to give me the name.
Oh, I just always wanted to be Captain USA. That's all.
Was it Captain USA?
No, it wasn't Captain USA.
Was it Captain Chaos? What name did he? What name was he when he would do that thing?
Captain Chaos, and then.
Then
his
he became.
Last line was like, you know.
I'll become Captain USA.
Right, that's okay. You know, he said, "JJ has Burt Reynolds."
You got to get rid of him.
Right.
Where he was
right.
Like yelling.
Like, I'm sick of him, and he tears off the mask. Right.
Yeah.
And then he says, "That's okay, because I always wanted to be Captain USA."
And then you know what Burt Reynolds did at that point?
Then everyone started laughing. And
how did Burt Reynolds laugh, though?
You do the best laugh. It was I heard it earlier today.
He went.
Yeah, that's awesome.
You don't know who that woman was, do you?
Do you? No, I don't. I know exactly what she looked like, and that she looked great in her matching skin-tight like blue leather cap.
That's correct.
And that
now,
black Lamborghini that they rode along in.
Yeah, they had that car, and remember, like they would get police officers to like let them go because they would like zip down like the the zipper going down their
Adrian Barbeau was
jumpsuit.
Great too. She would somehow always be riding shotgun when that happened.
Let me do you remember what Dom DeLuise's character's name was, what his real name was?
Well, JJ, and it was J.J. McClure, right?
That was J.J. McClure, yeah. isn't it maybe the greatest movie ever made, Cannonball Run?
The greatest thing about Cannonball Run was I hadn't had cable up until that point in my life.
Yeah.
And I was just able to pirate cable.
And it just...
Right when it was being endlessly played on HBO.
It had to have been one of the first movies I saw on cable. And I just watched it every single time it was on.
I saw it in the theaters.
I actually don't think I saw it on the big screen. I think it's time. You know what would be perfect? A 20th anniversary, just like they did with Apocalypse Now. I say they bring back on the IMAX screen up on the 65th Street,
yeah.
Cannonball Run in IMAX.
Oh, beautiful.
Wouldn't it be so awesome to see Burt Convy riding that motorcycle around?
Yeah, doing a wheelie across the USA.
Joe Klecko.
Yeah, jumping out of that plane, singing whatever the hell song it was.
Or Peter Fonda starting that motorcycle fight with Jackie Chan.
Half of your ass or part of your ass.
Or the fantastic Roger Moore as Seymour Goldfarb Jr. Do you remember that?
Yes, and Jamie Farr, I remember even. I think that would really go over well now.
Yeah, I think that would actually. And you know what Jamie Farr's character's name was in the movie?
I have no idea. I don't remember that.
Sheik.
Just
the Sheik.
Not like the Sheik Jr. Wasn't he like the son of some Sheik?
I think we found that out during Cannonball 2.
Oh, yeah.
Where he was in... Remember with Don Don in Cannonball 2? Who played Don Don?
I just remember that a Sinatra was in that one.
Yes, he was. But do you remember who played Don Don?
Don Don? Was that an ape?
Charles Nelson Reilly.
Oh, yes, of course. And he actually has lost his toupee in that movie.
Yes.
Flying through a solid concrete.
Dom DeLuise's character's name was Victor.
Oh, Victor.
And
it's amazing that such a movie was even more important to someone else's life than it was to mine.
And you know, there's a great Cannonball Run story about Frank Sinatra when he saw... he said to... To Dean and Sammy, who were in it as, they were in the movie as, respectively, they were, I have it right here, Jamie Blake was, Dean Martin's character's name.
Yeah.
And, Sammy Davis Jr. was Morris Fenderbaum.
Of
and they posed as priests.
Right, right.
And,
In a red Ferrari.
Yeah, and they were just like, bless you, my son. They'd like pull over and like, and it was like that one time when JJ said, didn't he say like the priest was like grabbing like a young boy or something, and then like they got beat up. Remember that? Didn't like he
grabbing
set them
a
up?
Young boy.
Didn't he like set them up and like told somebody that they were fake priests? Like there's two. He said there's two guys posing as priests. Running around, and if you...
I thought they were at least Dino was mostly trying to chase aside from the martinis all the skirts, right?
Yeah, he was which is like was the saddest sight ever. It's like Dean Martin, like, so far over the hill, just trying to be like a stud.
Right, right, definitely.
But anyway, when Frank Sinatra saw the movie, he said to them, he said, "Hey, why don't you guys ever ask me to be in one of your bleeping Cannonball movies? like they look like fun." And then they got him in Cannonball 2. Do you know who the writer...
That wasn't as fun, I don't think. Maybe it was as fun on the set.
Oh, it looks like it was just fun on the set and just torture for anyone.
Well, I suppose it was more fun because they didn't even make it hardly onto the road in that movie.
There was, like, barely any run in it. It just stopped at a point and there was, like, a fight for, like, 45 minutes.
Yeah, they stopped somewhere around Arizona.
They had to go and, like, rescue somebody. It was, like, so stupid.
And Cannonball. The whole race was summed up in a cartoon.
Oh, that's right, where all of a sudden it was like they showed the fight, then all of a sudden it's like... like that race music.
Right, right.
And then they just showed, like, cartoon cars going, like, literally for all of the race that we should have just been thrilling to.
Yeah, it was also one of those wacky red arrows that...
Yeah, like...
going way across the country.
Yeah, going off course and... But I need to know who the other woman was.
Wow, that's a toughie.
Well, we got to get it. And
well, if you don't, I'm going to stick these rosary beads right up your nose.
That's a line from the movie.
Right.
Now, you talk about the names being like almost from a different era in the movie. Do you know who the writer of the Cannonball Run was?
Well, wasn't it the same guy?
Well, it wasn't Hal Needham.
Oh, he was the director.
He was the director who directed
Hooper and all that.
He directed Smokey 1, Smokey 2, Hooper, Cannonball 1, Cannonball 2, Stroker Race.
Stunt Buddy.
Yeah, Mega Force. He directed a lot of great movies. But the writer's name is Brock Yates.
Brock Yates. That sounds like a porn writer.
Which is just like the greatest name for like anyone, like, to have a career. Brock Yates wrote... I'm looking at his filmography right now.
Did he write any good hit songs?
Brock Yates wrote Smokey and the Bandit 2, Cannonball Run, Two of a Kind for TV, and then something for TV called Bandit, Bandit, Bandit.
Oh, that must have been some Smokey and the Bandit shoot-off or whatever,
yeah,
whatever you call
exact,
it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Oh, I love...
Probably was a shoot-off for, you know, Brock.
Aren't those the greatest movies ever? Smokey and the Bandit and Cannonball Run.
Well, I was always partial to, because Cannonball Run, you know, it was like the whole, well, let me ask you if you remember, which movies you remember better. Do you remember Cannonball Run better, or you impacted more by Cannonball Run, or like, you know, It's a Mad, 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 Mad World?
Well, I used to watch that movie, It's a Mad, 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 Mad World, every year with my family, or on, like, Christmas, we would watch that movie.
Oh, wow, that's interesting.
So it was like, you know, other families.
We all hooted and watched Jonathan Winters.
We watched Jonathan Winters. And then the amazing thing is, it's just like, if you go watch the movie now, you can't believe how slow moving it is. Like, the movie now, it's just like, it's like Sid Caesar's locked in that cellar.
Oh, yeah.
It's like an hour and a half of him being trapped in the cellar with the shovels trying to get out. Like, set. And it's like, like, the action is so sparse in it, like, you can't believe that that at any point in my life I ever thought that it was, like, a thrill-a-minute movie.
I haven't seen it in such a long time. I don't, I think you're ruining it for me, too. You're bursting my nostalgia bubble.
It's still good, but you'll be amazed by it moves so much slower than you will have remembered.
Mm.
All right.
Don't say that.
From now on, your name on the show... Anytime you call up, you know you have to tell me?
All right.
Say, my name is J.J. McClure. Okay?
Wow, that's a badge of honor, Tom.
It is. I'm giving you the, that's like me making you a major.
Yes, I will wear that. I'll probably make some, well, I don't really sew. But I'll try to make some sort of, and I'll work on the laugh, too.
Work on it right now. Let's try it right now. Oh,
that's awesome.
All right. Well, thanks for calling, JJ. Yes, all right. Bye.
Signing off.
Oh, who doesn't love Smokey the Bandit and Cannonball Run? See, that's what the best thing about this show is. We want to talk about that. We'll talk about it. I don't care. I need somebody to call, though, because I have to test something out. I need to hear from a caller because there's something I need to test out. 201-200-9368 for a new feature of the show, which I don't know if you remember hearing me mention it. It's something we will be adding to the program as a feature when a call goes south. WFMU, you're on the air.
Hi.
Hi.
It's Nadia.
It's Nadia.
Are you going to flush me? Is that it?
Well, do you want to get flushed?
I don't care. You can flush me if you really want to.
Hey, I have an idea. Okay. Now, I want to run this by you on the radio now.
What?
Now, as everybody knows, Nadia is one of the teens who is a part of the Teenage Girl Night on the show. You are 15, correct?
Yeah.
And your birthday is in what month?
January.
How would you like? You don't have to say yes right now and start getting all excited right now.
Okay.
How would you like to have on this show a sweet 16 birthday party?
I don't think I'd like that at all.
I'm going to take that as a yes.
No.
What if I had a band here, like a good band?
What band?
I don't know. We'll work on getting a good band to come up and play your sweet 16 birthday party.
Okay. If you have a good band, I'll do it.
I'm going to work on that. And we'll have cake.
Cake.
And ice cream.
And soda.
And soda.
Good.
So you'd be interested in that?
Sure, why not?
Okay, everybody, in January, pencil it in. Nadia is going to have her sweet 16 birthday party on the air.
Cool.
Is that cool?
Why though?
Because it's your sweet 16 birthday.
Okay.
Well, you don't like that?
No, I don't. Would that even be interesting to people to listen to?
I think so. To hear you and your friends all eating cake and ice cream.
Could we have, like, a pillow fight?
Possibly. What if it was a sleepover?
The Sweet 16 Slumber Party?
Yeah, at the station.
Except, at the station.
Except, like, we don't sleep over.
We just call it a sleepover.
Yeah.
Do we get to wear pajamas?
No. Because we're not actually sleeping over.
But
we're leaving at 11.
Yeah.
When the show's over. I'm kicking all of you out.
Oh.
So it's kind of not a sleepover.
At all.
Yes.
There's nothing about that's a sleepover.
There's
besides the fact that it's called a sleepover.
Yes, there's no element of actual sleeping over. No. There will
be
none.
Well, the band would be cool. I want a band.
You want a band?
Yeah. Could we get, I don't know. Forget it.
I don't know.
What's a good band?
A good band? I don't know. We'll figure that out. We'll get somebody up here. Don't worry, it'll be fun.
So you got your flushing thing going?
Say something annoying.
I want to talk about it first, and then you can flush me.
Okay, what do you want to talk about?
I just want to talk about the whole flush. Is it going to be something you always do?
It might be, when a call goes
particularly. Is it going to be, like, the signature Tom Scharpling flush?
It might be.
Will people think of your show and then think of the flush? Will that automatically ring in their ears, the flushing sound of a toilet?
Well, why don't we find out?
But
get off my phone. You've been flushed! Oh, that's the sweetest sound I've ever heard. FMU, you're on the air.
Hello.
Hey, how you doing?
Not too bad. How are you?
I'm all right.
I just had a guess at the identity of the second woman. But before you hang up on me, I came in the middle of this.
You mean before I flush you?
Before you flush me.
Uh-huh.
I came in the middle of the Cannonball Run thing. Did you at all cover the sort of lurid middle finger of Jack Elam?
Oh, that's right, the doctor.
The proctologist, because that image still haunts me. It seemed excessively long and gnarly.
Yeah, that was really creepy when he would, you know, shot creeped me out in the movie when he took the hypodermic needle and sprayed it into his mouth.
Yes, that also was highly
and he was
disturbing.
Like, that's good. I was like, so creepy.
And also, I ran into a conceptual artist about a year ago who had written an entire structuralist analysis of Cannonball Run, and he had examined the image of Adrian Barbeau's car in the desert alone, and the sound, and how the sound was sort of worked over in the soundtrack in comparison to the location of the car in the shot.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Yeah, he thought about it way too much. But let me make my guess.
Okay.
Was it Cheryl Ladd?
No.
Ah. Oh, well.
Do you want to know who it was?
Yes.
Should I say who it was? Or should I let people keep guessing?
You don't have that much time, and I don't know. It's not that interesting to linger over.
It was...
What is that?
I'm sorry about that. I think I got that. I'm going back to the music. Here's something from a rock band.
We'll be right back. what you want, ooh, the children of the revolution. Now you want, ooh, the children of the revolution. Now, now, now.
All right, hey, we just heard from T-Rex, taken from the Great Hits 1972 to 1977 collection, Children of the Revolution. Before that, the Volcano Suns, a two for Tuesday from the Volcano Suns. We heard What's Happening to Me and Shriney from the fantastic album Farce from 1988. Oneida, who are the Volcano Suns of the 21st century. From their new album called Anthem of the Moon, we heard Rose and Licorice. And starting us off, Dan Melchior's Broke Review, their new album Heavy Dirt. We heard You Know That I Will. Only 5 minutes left in the show. Hey, people have been posting on the FMU message board saying that they want me to do my Nostradamus scholar show. I think we are going to have Nostradamus expert John Hogue, I believe his name is, on the show next week. I think it might be next week. I got to check that. We got an email from Leon saying, great show, Tom. I also watch Cannonball Run far too many times on HBO. Have you seen the film it ripped off, The Gumball Rally? It's by far the better movie. Ah, that's not true. Fooey on you, Leon. You're wrong. You're as wrong as wrong can be. Paul checking in saying it's Tara Buckman. Okay, that's correct. Bill checking in. He says, Tom, as a Yankee fan, I am outraged. We all know that Mariano is not invincible. Having hit a batter and giving up two hits, he should have been taken out of the game after Arizona tied. Mendoza was already in the bullpen and should have been brought in. He's one of the greatest pitchers in the game, and they hardly use him. And he also says, along the lines of poor managing, back in 1993, Buck Showalter would, on many occasions, bench Don Mattingly, O'Neill, and Boggs on the same day, essentially showcasing, sabotaging the 1993 season. And he also says, as for automobile movie trivia, who starred in the early 1970s film Corvette Summer? Come on, that's easy. Mark Hamill. Who'd he co-star with? That's a better question. Do you know that? Annie Potts. And Mark Hamill did Corvette Summer. I think that was the movie where his face got mashed up. Is that correct? That's why he had to do Empire Strikes Back. That's why they wrote in a whole thing in Empire Strikes Back with him, like, held upside down in the ice caves of Hoth so that they could show how come his face looked like hamburger meat. Like, they justified it by showing that. Like, oh, he's, Luke is captured and he's in the thing and he just got hit in the face by an ice monster on Hoth. And real quick, before we say goodnight, a couple reviews, Amazon.com, people reviewing Cannonball Run in their review section. This just shows why there are horse races, because everyone's got a different opinion. This one guy says 5 stars for the Cannonball Run DVD. His review is entitled, Hilarious Cross Country Fun. And he says, a classic 80s comedy with big name stars and lots of cool cars. This is a type of movie that shouldn't be critiqued and nitpicked. A flick where a person should shut their brain off for an hour and a half and enjoy. So he goes on. I mean, like, he writes the thing. He might as well be writing, like, literally for a review for, like, a press kit. Based on a true race event, Burt Reynolds leads the all-star cast in the ultimate racing event, the Cannonball Run. A bunch of people in souped-up cars, some disguised, some not, vow for the title of winner in the race, and they will do anything to get it. Reynolds plays J.J. McClure, who, with his trusty sidekick Victor, Dom DeLuise, disguise their vehicle as an ambulance, thinking that cops would never pull a car like that over. Along the way, they pick up a freaky doctor, Jack Elam, and a female patient named Pamela, Farrah Fawcett. Others stand in their way, such as 2 female hotties, Adrian Barbeau and Tara Buckman, in a black Lamborghini. Jackie Chan playing himself in a... He didn't play Jackie Chan in the movie. Jackie Chan didn't play Jackie Chan. I'm condemning this review right there. And then here's an alternate review someone else put up. 1 star. This movie should come with a Surgeon General warning. This movie may cause death from severe boredom and or depression at the knowledge that you paid money for it. It is so bad that I actually threw it out rather than resell it. In doing so, I saved some innocent person from having this inflicted upon them. Do not buy this. You think Amazon.com would take that down, like, from... But they didn't. And then here's the next review. 5 stars. The guy says, wow! With 3 exclamation points. 4 exclamation points. What a film to say I was thrilled to bits. What a film to say I was thrilled to bits would be an understatement. Everything was just right for me. The comedy was there combined with the occasional piece of action. Occasional? Did this guy see the same movie as I saw? I gotta get the Cannonball soundtrack up here. And the guy's from England, too. It's good to see Cannonball Run plays on the universal stage. It translates. He says also, whilst Roger Moore. Whilst Roger Moore did a fantastic job belittling himself whilst keeping... He used the word whilst twice in the same sentence. Whilst Roger Moore did a fantastic job of belittling himself whilst keeping his usual blend of humor and charm there for the audience to see. Like, he doesn't end the sentence correctly. Like, he, like, sets it up and then just, like, to miss this film would be a crime. This text refers to the VHS tape edition. Oh, I got to get it on DVD. If anybody wants to meet me at Best Buy tomorrow, they can watch me purchase the Cannonball Run DVD. As well as, if there's a good chance, if you follow me around the hall, you can watch me deface their men's room also, which I do every time I go there. I take the roll of toilet paper off the roll, and I jam it with my foot into the actual toilet so that it's broken. And then I tell the manager, hey man, something's wrong with the bathroom in there. It's all flooded all over the floor. And then I don't do that anymore. Hey, it's time for Nickel and Dime Radio. I'm going to get out of the whiz-ay here and turn the microphone over to Small Chizange, because it's his shizzo. You are listening to WFMU East Orange, WXHD Mount Hope Worldwide on the World Wide Web at WFMU.org. This is the best show on WFMU. We will be back next Tuesday. Thanks for listening. And thanks to Dave, my producer. And stay tuned for Small Change. Bye.